But today's project is a different one. Today's project is to learn about international trade, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we discuss today some theorists that try to explain world trade and try to explain why the rich countries trade with the poor countries, why also the rich countries trade with other rich countries, and why the poor countries do not trade very much with other poor countries. Yes? And we studied also why there are call centers in Romania. Yes? And why Paula worked at Delphi, and the capital she used was just a telephone and a computer. And why in the United States, in Delphi, where they make injectors and pumps, they have factories with lots of capital. Yes? And why she was paid very little. Tell us, Paula, being discreet. Tell us your wage at Delphi.
Well, I can tell you the fact that the wage at Delphi is definitely bigger than on Conduent, on the call center I've talked to you about. Mm-hmm. And of course, they respect their employees. Mm-hmm. But also,
a big company.
A yes.
Multinational. But if you compare probably the wage they pay you with the wage they pay their workers in the US.
Of course, things are different. Yes.
You would be amazed.
Yes, but that happens everywhere.
But that's even not normal. It has to do with productivity and it has to do with capital per worker, right?
Even if we take an example, the supermarkets and the employees in there, for example, let's take Lidl or Carrefour, Kaufland, comparatively with the foreigner ones, are less paid in Romania.
Yes, but in those cases, it's not so exaggerated, yes? But yes, there is a difference, right? But if you look how much someone who works in a factory like those in the US, someone who has to push the buttons in some machines like Homer Simpson. Do you know Homer Simpson? You don't know Homer Simpson. You don't know the Simpsons.
No. Shame on me.
How about you, Christian? Do you know?
It's the best cartoon, American cartoon. Oh, yes. I can't stop laughing every time I see Bart. What's her name? Marge, Lisa, and I can't remember the old guy, the Simpson himself. What's his name? But it's very funny.
Simpson works in a nuclear power plant.
Oh.
And he just has to press some buttons there or something. Yeah. I'm sure that Homer Simpson earns much more money than Paula at Delphi.
Yes, of course, but we have to take in our account that there are people which are very good and have and work in a different field. For example, in Delphi, we have engineers and stuff like that, technical, you know, people which worked a lot but trained in a different field, you know, than mine. So, of course, they take lots of money, even in Romania.
They have human capital.
Yes.
Good.
I imagine.
So, today we discussed about trade, yes? But I had many interruptions today in the lecture because of the problems, the technical problems that they had in Chernivtsi. And they were all the time trying to contact me by mobile phone and by the Facebook. And I had many interruptions at the beginning. And then at the end, I could not see the people from Chernivtsi. I didn't know if they were connected or not. Only you were left in the end. And I was not sure about going further very much, yes, with the content or not, because I couldn't see them. I found out that they followed on YouTube, that those in Chernivtsi, at least one of the two groups we have there, they were able to follow the lecture on YouTube live, which was a good thing. And we saw international trade. We saw the theories that try to explain international trade. And we tried to explain the main patterns of international trade, right? We tried to explain the north-south trade, but also the north-north trade. Yes, intra-industry trade, usually in monopolistically competitive markets, in markets where different brands of the same kind of products compete. Yes, Renault with Volkswagen, we said, for instance. But we didn't discuss about policy. How about trade policy? What is the best trade policy for development? If you think about our introduction today, we talked about Adam Smith and the Wealth of Nations. And Adam Smith is a key defendant of free trade. He explains why free trade is like specialization in one industrial firm that allows to be more productive. And he extends that to countries, to the Wealth of Nations. If countries also specialize and they trade, then they can be more productive. So free trade is good for development, and it could be good for development also for developing countries, for countries in Africa, for countries in Eastern Europe. And for countries in general in the developing world, what is known as the global south. But the issue is that there are also other trade theories that we saw later, the new trade theories, and we also discussed the importance of economies of scale. Yes? And why, for instance, when you produce cars, if you produce 2,000, you can make them cheaper than if you just produce 1,000 cars per year. And if you produce 100,000 cars per year, you can be even more productive. And there are some countries that are big countries, they are industrialized countries, and they already have those economies of scale. And sometimes the governments in developing countries, they argue that in order to be able to develop, they need to protect their infant industries. So this is called the infant industry argument. And the infant industry argument claims that the industries that are new in developing countries can be protected temporarily until they develop enough to have economies of scale and be able to compete internationally with the other companies. Yes? This is an argument. Yes? It's a valid argument. But then it has many dangers. Yes? It has many dangers because there can be incentives for people who are businessmen in one developing country to try to protect their own industries for their own interests, yes, and to charge higher prices to consumers in the country and not to face foreign competition. And this is not good for development. It's just their own selfish interest to have protection in order to charge higher prices to consumers. There is a second problem, which is the problem of how to identify what the infant industries are. What are the key sectors that the government in a developing country should protect in order to develop? And there is a risk. There is a risk that the country protects some sector that is not the key sector where economies of scale can be achieved. Yes? We can make a mistake. It can be a true mistake, without any bad intentions. Yes? And then there is a third problem, which is that the other trading partners can retaliate if third countries, they protect their own industries in order to support their infant industries. Then the countries in Europe or in the US or in other developed regions of the world, they can retaliate with their own tariffs, their own protections. Yes? And this can harm other industries in the developing country too. So it's a difficult thing. It's an argument. It makes some sense, but it's difficult. Yes? Because it's very dangerous and it's not clear. From an empirical point of view, some proponents of the argument say that, for instance, the United States was very protectionist when it was developing. They say that the United States, until the Second World War, was very protectionist. Since its independence and until the Second World War, the US was very protectionist. And they say that this may have allowed the US to develop. And now the US does not like that other countries that need to develop want to do the same, want to introduce protection. It is an argument. But there are also other arguments. If you think about the example of Brazil, Brazil is a country that is somehow also a developing country. In the 1980s, Brazil wanted to promote its own computer production industry. They wanted to build computers in Brazil. And they started protecting the industry. They introduced protection for computers. Yes, tariffs against importing computers from other countries in order to protect the local industry and to develop a local computer hardware industry. But what was the result? The result was that in Brazil, this industry did not develop really. And they just used this protection to copy some low-end computers from other countries and to sell them at high prices in the protected Brazilian market. So the argument, but you should know the argument, yes? It's called the infant industry argument. It's an argument for protection. And it has some points, some valid points, the idea of these economies of scale, yes? And also empirically, it has some, may have some support in the case of the US, but then it has many dangers, yes? Theoretically, you can identify many dangers, the possibility that other countries retaliate, the possibility that the government is not able to identify correctly what sectors should be protected, the possibility that the, what was the first one that I mentioned before? The possibility that it is used by producers in the less developed country for rent-seeking purposes, yes? To benefit from other people just to charge higher prices to consumers, yes? And it's dangerous. empirically, it's also dangerous. You see the case in Brazil, where this infant industry argument was applied, and it didn't work. Yes, it just created artificially higher prices for consumers, but a local industry was not really developed. And you have also examples in other regions of the world. You have, for example, the case of the Asian tigers. Have you heard this expression, the Asian tigers? These countries like Singapore and Hong Kong and Taiwan and so on, these countries that are relatively developed, they have had an open system. They have had free trade, and this has encouraged them to be competitive. So it's not clear if protection is good for developing countries. But you should know that there are some arguments for that. Yes? Good. Kirill, welcome. You are at home now.
No, I'm not home.
Not home? But it looks like home.
Yes, it's my work.
Ah, nice place. Good. So we also have with us Tiberio and Paula. Paula is at home and Tiberio is at home, right?
Yes.
And we have Georgiana at home. Are you at home? Georgiana has a very nice home. And she has many books. She always shows her books there. Yes? But I also have one book, Kirill. Beginner's Ukrainian. But yes, Kirill speaks Russian, Georgiana. Only that for me it's more difficult to learn Russian because it's I want to learn first the Ukrainian as a bridge to learn Russian later. Yes? Yeah. Because Ukrainian is more similar to Romanian, for instance. Yes? Do you know how do you say a cup in Romanian? A cup. Oh. How?
Chapka.
Chapka.
Yeah, I believe so.
In Ukrainian is the same. Chapka. Oh. Yes, or when you go and buy coverage, yes, you can choose. Usually they tell you, do you want it with sesame or do you want it with what? With sesame or with? Tiberio knows.
Mac.
Mac is also the same in Ukrainian.
Yeah, No.
I don't know how, but Mac, I know it's the same in Ukrainian. Good. So, the infant industry argument for development, yes, I doubt very much if it's a good argument or not, but it's something that you should know that exists. The infant industry argument, right? Good. And then also we did not discuss about international finance, about the movements of capital internationally, yes? But we mentioned a little bit that it was related to trade in a way, yes? And do you know what the balance of payments is? How about you, Georgiana? Have you heard this expression, the balance of payments?
Well, no, not really. I'm not sure.
The balance of payments is like an accounting document that records all the international transactions between one country and other countries. And the balance of payments include the balance of trade, yes, and it includes also the balance of capital, yes. But what you should know is the balance of payments is always in equilibrium. So the balance of payments includes trade, includes capital, yes. But the addition of everything in the balance of payments should add to zero. So if you have an imbalance in trade, you should compensate this imbalance with capital, for instance, right? So usually the countries like Romania, very often they tend to have a deficit in the balance of trade. They tend to import more goods than they export. They tend to buy more foreign goods than they sell Romanian goods abroad. And they have a trade deficit. Yes, but this is compensated because of a surplus in the balance of capital, because there's more foreign investment in Romania than there is Romanian investment abroad. So it compensates. So when people tell you, oh, it's a very bad thing that Romania has a trade deficit, that Romania imports too much, it's a bad thing. But then they tell you it's a good thing that Romania receives foreign investments. As much as it's impossible to have both. Mathematically, yes, if you have foreign investment, you should compensate it with a trade deficit. Because you have foreign investment, it means that foreigners are investing, are giving you products to collect them later in the future, right? To have a profit in the future, that is an investment when you spend something now in order to have some profits in the future. Good, is this clear or not? How about you, Tiberio? I didn't see you today. So tell us. Remember, we didn't say this in the lecture. Balance of payments. It's an accounting document, yes? That records all the international transactions of one country. And these transactions can be of different types. They can be trade related, or they can be capital related, right? But the balance of payments as a whole, always by definition, has to be balanced.
Yes, it's something in your account, it always has to be zero.
Yes. So usually, when you have a lot of foreign investment, it means that you are also importing more goods than you are exporting.
Yes? But you cannot see the difference.
It is good or not? Is foreign investment good or not for development?
Efficient foreign investment, yes, but not all investment is.
Well, foreign investment, you know, if your country is corrupt, maybe. And yeah, maybe the investment goes to sectors that are not productive.
Exactly.
But in general, if your country is a market economy and it's a legal system that favors profitable activities, yes, then foreign investment will go to sectors that are efficient and are profitable. Yes? Like, for instance, call centers for Paula to work in them, yes? Or Georgiana. It's productive, yes? And people can do a job that they can do it cheaper or better than in other places. Yes? Good. But of course, there are many theories about foreign investment and about debt, yes? And there are some theories in development economics that say that debt can be used to try to control foreign governments, to have dependent countries, yes? So if you have some very powerful country that is lending money to other country always, and this other country is always in debt, yes? And sometimes this can be promoted on purpose to have this country dependent on you, yes? And the major powers in the world, like the United States, like Russia, yes, like other powers, they also have some countries that have a lot of debt with them. And they renew the debts and they, yes, but it's also a way to control those countries. How about Ukraine, Kirill? I'm interested in Ukraine. Does Ukraine have foreign debt or not?
Can you repeat, please?
Yes, my question is about Ukraine. If Ukraine has foreign debt, if Ukraine owes money to other countries in the world?
I can't tell you about this because I didn't know exactly.
I tell you, it owes a lot of money to Russia, for instance, right? So, but it will owe money also increasingly to the United States, to the European Union, yes, to other powers that also want to invest in Ukraine. Foreign investment can be a good thing, yes, as Tiberius said, if it's productive, yes, if it's used for productive purposes. If it's just investment in corruption or things like those, then probably it's not the same. Tiberiu, what can you tell me about corruption in Romania?
I would say it's rampant, but I think it's lessened over the years compared to maybe the 90s.
Less and less, right?
It was a bigger problem then.
But this is a really interesting topic, corruption. And next week we will discuss about it, about whether foreign aid, you know, this official development aid is good for development or not. Yes? And we will discuss this in the next week, in the next lecture.